Nudged presents Storm Horse by Nick Garlick, narrated by Malk Williams. Chapter 1. A Storm and a Funeral. The wind howled, rain lashed against the windows. The ferry boat lurched as a wave of dirty brown water slammed into its side, and for one terrifying instant, Flip thought they were going to capsize. His throat closed up, the blood roared in his ears, and he squeezed his eyes tight shut, expecting the sea to come crashing in around him any second. Then the boat righted itself and ploughed on through the heaving sea. It was heading for Mossum, the tiny island that was to be Flip's new home. He wasn't looking forward to it. He didn't feel happy. He'd never been to the island, and he didn't know anybody who lived on it. Nobody, that is, except for the silent, forbidding figure beside him. Uncle Andres. Uncle Andres scared Flip. He'd scared him from the moment they'd met 2 days before, when he'd arrived in the city to arrange his brother's funeral. His brother was Flip's father, and as Flip's mother had left them 3 years before and never been heard from since, 12-year-old Flip was all alone in the world. His uncle's appearance had only made him feel more alone. He'd walked into the house where Flip had been staying, looked the boy up and down and said, "I'm your father's older brother. You will call me Uncle Andres." He was a tall man, with a big head that looked even bigger because his hair had been cut so short that the back and sides were almost bald. The sleeves of his jacket and the legs of his trousers were short too, and made his hands and feet stick out. He loomed over Flip like a silent giant expecting a reply. Then he frowned.
"Don't you shake hands here in the city?" he asked. "It's considered good manners where I come from."
Flip was too startled to speak. He'd never seen a picture of his uncle in his life. Even more confusing, Uncle Andres had a very thick northern accent Flip found hard to understand, and he'd been busy concentrating on listening instead of offering a greeting.
"I suppose," Uncle Andres continued, "your father never bothered teaching you. That does not surprise me."
I'm sorry," Flip began, finally holding out a trembling hand. But Uncle Andres had already left the room. He took Flip back to the flat where Flip had lived with his father, then left to speak to the landlord. Finally, he went out. When he returned, he said he'd made all the arrangements for the funeral. He also said he'd arranged with the authorities for Flip to come and live with him, and told him he should pack everything he wanted to take in 2 suitcases. Only 2. Then he'd made them both supper and gone to bed. Not once had he asked Flip how he was. He didn't ask the next day either. The two of them got up, ate a silent breakfast, and carried their suitcases to the cemetery. There they stood at the graveside, listening to the priest intone the service. Flip did his best to pay attention, but he couldn't concentrate. He missed his dad, but he missed his mum even more, and all he could do as he stood beside his uncle was keep looking up and across the gravestones to the cemetery gates, hoping, really, really hoping, that she would come walking through them any minute. Even though she'd left them all those years ago, Flip couldn't believe his mum would leave him on his own now. But she never appeared, and Flip's loneliness only deepened. With a start, he realized that the service was over. He looked up to see Uncle Andres shaking the priest's hand, then scooping up some earth and letting it fall slowly onto the coffin.
"It's time to go," he said.
Less than 30 minutes later, they were in a train heading north, and Flip had his face pressed to the window, watching as the canals, bridges, and bustling pavements of Amsterdam faded away. In their place came nothing but kilometre after kilometre of flat green fields, dotted with sheep and cows. He wondered if he'd ever see his home again. The boat heaved wildly again, jolting Flip out of his memories. He could see a smudge of land ahead, which meant they'd nearly arrived,
But the sky was even darker now, and the wind even fiercer. Foam-flecked waves crashed against the side of the ferry. Flip, who'd never been anywhere near the sea in his life, was terrified. He clung grimly to his suitcases with every ghastly roll of the vessel and prayed for the journey to be over. He was certain he was going to be sick any minute, and if he wasn't sick, he thought, then it would only be because the ferry had sunk and everyone on board had drowned. Beside him, Uncle Andries paid the weather no attention at all. He didn't even seem to know that there was a storm. He sat bolt upright with his arms folded across his chest and gazed out of the windows as though the sun were shining and the sea was as flat as a pond. In the end, Flip wasn't sick, and as the minutes crept by and Mossum's Harbour drew ever closer, the wind began to fade and the sea to calm. Soon the rolling stopped completely and the ferry glided gently in towards the dock. The crew threw ropes to the men on dry land to tie her fast. The other passengers gathered their belongings, ready to disembark. But Uncle Andries remained in his seat. He stared down at Flip. "I have something to say to you," he said. Flip, whose stomach was still rolling, waited in nervous silence. "Your father and I were not friends," Uncle Andries said. "Did you know that?" Flip had absolutely no idea how to reply, so all he did was nod again. "He was lazy," Uncle Andries continued. "He didn't like working on the farm. When our father died, your father left and went to Amsterdam. He became a thief. This is why we never spoke after he left, because I do not like thieves. If you want something in this world, you must earn it. You can't just take it the way your father did." In front of them, the passengers were lining up before the exit. Uncle Andries still hadn't moved. "I say this," he continued, "because I want you to know what to expect from me. I did not trust my brother, and I am not sure whether I trust you. I think you may have picked up many bad habits from him. But I am your new father now, so I will look after you. That is my duty. My wife Elka is your new mother, and my daughter Laurentia is your new sister. You will treat them both with respect. You will also do what I say, and you will not argue with me, because small boys do not argue with their fathers. And that," he finished, "is all I have to say. So now we will leave." He got up, took his case and one of Flip's, then walked away without a backward glance. Flip followed reluctantly. In his hand was the other suitcase, the one he'd guarded jealously every inch of the way from home to the cemetery and then to the station. That had been hard, really hard. It was so heavy it had kept banging against his legs as he walked, no matter how much he'd shifted it from hand to hand. It was just as bad lugging it off the boat and down the gangplank, because now he not only had aching fingers to deal with, but a queasy stomach and legs still wobbly from the trip across the Varden Sea. But he never let on. He never gave a sign of how he felt. The last thing he wanted was for his uncle to discover what was in the case. It was too important to him to let that happen. As they stepped onto dry land, the clouds above them parted and a thick, dazzling beam of sunlight shone down directly onto the dock. The holidaymakers ahead of them clapped their hands and let out a happy cheer. Flip, with Uncle Andries' last words still ringing in his ears, had never felt so lonely in all his life. Chapter 2. Mossum. Waiting on a horse-drawn cart near the foot of the gangway were a blonde-haired woman and a little girl. As Flip and his uncle approached, the woman climbed down and stepped forward. "This is my wife," said Uncle Andries. "Her name is Elka. You will call her Aunt Elka."
"It's Ellie," she said, "just like everyone else on the island calls me."
But she smiled as she said it and gave her husband a kiss on his cheek to welcome him home.
"I like Elka," Flip heard his uncle mutter as he put his suitcases in the cart.
"Well, you're the only one who does," she said.
But she said that with a smile, too. She seemed to have a face made for smiling. It lit up the gloomy surroundings and made Flip feel just a little bit less lonely.
"I was very sorry to hear about your father," she went on, and unlike her husband, she really did look sad about her brother-in-law's death. "But now you're here, I hope you'll be happy. I hope you'll enjoy your new home."
Uncle Andres turned to the little girl, waiting impatiently to be introduced. "This," he said, "is your cousin Laurentia."
"But everyone calls me Renska," she said, jumping down to stand beside her mother. "That's short for Laurentia. I'm 7. Our horse is called Layla. Did you really live in Amsterdam?"
Flip nodded. Both mother and daughter had the same northern accent as Uncle Andres, and he had to concentrate to make out what they were saying. Growing up in Amsterdam hadn't prepared him for this, and he wondered if it would always be so difficult to understand the islanders.
"Is it true there's water everywhere you look?" Renska asked. "And do the houses keep falling into the canals? My friend Loche says the houses are always falling into the canals in Amsterdam. She's my pen pal. She writes to me. She lives in Groningen and has a television. Did you have a television?"
"No," Flip said.
"We don't either," Renska said. "We're poor."
"We are not poor," Aunt Ellie said. "We just don't have any money."
"What's the difference?" Renska asked.
"A lot," Aunt Ellie said. Renska pouted.
"Loche says if you don't have a television, you must be poor."
"I've got candles in the cupboard with more sense than your friend Loche," Aunt Ellie said. "And what she knows about Amsterdam, you could fit into the head of a mouse and still have room left over for a bookcase."
Flip moved a little closer to hear his aunt more clearly. He didn't realise he'd ended up standing next to the horse until both Aunt Ellie and Renska stared at him.
"Well, well, well," Aunt Ellie said, surprise all over her face. "She's never done that before."
"What?"
Flip whispered nervously, wondering if he'd made a mistake.
"Layla," Renska said. "She's scared of strangers. She hardly ever lets anyone new get close to her."
And it was true. Layla hadn't shied away from Flip. In fact, she was leaning forward to sniff his pockets. When he turned towards her, she snorted warm air straight into his face.
"She likes you," Renska giggled.
"I think she does," Aunt Ellie agreed. "Do you like horses?" she asked Flip.
"I've never met a horse in my life," he replied. He was puzzled by Layla's behaviour, but he had to admit he liked it. The horse's presence was calming, comforting.
"Well, if they all react like that," Aunt Ellie said, "you'll do fine on Mossum.
We've got lots of horses on Mossum."
Uncle Andres was already sitting up on the front seat of the cart.
"Can we get on?" he demanded. "I've spent quite enough time away from the farm. I've got work to catch up on."
"All you've got to catch up on is supper," Aunt Ellie said, climbing up beside him. "Hendrik took care of everything, and Mr. Hofstra lent a hand yesterday afternoon. Everything's doing quite nicely, thank you."
"I'll be the judge of that," Andres muttered. Aunt Ellie just smiled.
Flip clambered into the back of the cart next to Renska, still clutching tight to his heavy suitcase. As they moved off, he saw a girl watching him. She was as thin as a stick, with long, stringy hair, so blonde it was almost white. Her eyes were big and round, and set in a face even paler than her hair. In her hand was a teddy bear. She didn't blink, and she didn't move. She just stared. But when 3 young boys appeared, she darted away behind a pile of wooden pallets and vanished. One of them threw a stone at her. Aunt Ellie sprang to her feet.
"You leave that girl alone," she shouted, "or I'll come down there and throw something at you."
The boys laughed. Aunt Ellie jumped off the cart and started after them, but the moment she did so, they ran off into a big white building at the end of the street.
"Those Mesman boys," she said to Uncle Andres, shaking her head. "They were in Mr. de Groot's garden while you were away, got into the chicken coop and smashed all the eggs."
"Did he see them?" he asked.
"He only heard them," Aunt Ellie said. "So, of course, their father said there wasn't any proof and refused to do anything about it."
"Who are the Mesman boys?" Flip asked Renska.
"Their father's Mr. Mesman," she said. "He owns the hotel. Papa says he wants to own the whole island and,
We don't talk about the Mesmans, Uncle Andres said without looking around.
Why not?
Renska asked. Because we don't, he said. And that was that. The cart rolled on into the village. It wasn't very big, not much more than two streets lined with towering elm trees that met at a crossroads in the middle. On one side of the crossroads was the hotel. On the other was a red brick church with the tall square tower Flip had seen from the ferry. He could see big cracks at the top under the roof. In front of the church was a sign calling for funds to help repair it. Flip saw a butcher's and a baker's and a greengrocer's shop, a cafe and a lot of small houses with white walls and grey tile roofs, tiny front gardens and neatly trimmed hedges. It was quiet, too. The only sound he could hear apart from the patter of the rain was the steady clip-clop-clip of Layla's hooves on the road. Renska told him that there were only two cars on the island. One belonged to the doctor and the other to Mr. Mesman. Nobody else could afford one, she said, so if you wanted to go anywhere, you either walked or rode a bike or travelled in a horse-drawn cart. It wasn't anything like Amsterdam with its rattling trams and roaring cars and people walking and talking wherever you looked. Flip had never known such stillness in all his life, and he couldn't help wondering what there was to do on Mossam. It all seemed so boring. Not far from the village was Uncle Andre's farm. The family lived in a small house whose ground floor was taken up almost entirely by an open, airy kitchen. It was warm and dry, without a speck of dust anywhere. Absolutely nothing like Flip's dark and shabby basement flat in Amsterdam. The sun hadn't ever shone through the windows there. Once inside the kitchen, Flip watched as Renska ran over to two doors in the wall and pulled them open to reveal a cupboard. When Flip looked closer, he realised that it wasn't a cupboard but a little bed with a quilt and a rag doll on a plump pillow.
I sleep here, she said proudly. Papa slept here when he was a boy, and so did his papa.
Isn't there a bedroom upstairs? Flip asked.
Yes, she said, but only one. That's for Mama and Papa.
Then where, thought Flip, am I going to sleep? He found out after supper when Aunt Ellie lit a gas lamp and led him across the farmyard and over to the barn. It was an old bent building, held up by massive wooden beams. Above a couple of horse stalls and a row of concrete cow stalls and milking equipment was a wooden floor. Most of that was filled with bales of hay and straw, but in one corner was a door. Aunt Ellie opened it to reveal a snug little room with a bed in one corner and a chest of drawers in the other.
"This used to be where your great-grandfather made clogs for the islanders," she said, "back when men didn't wear anything else on their feet. We haven't used it in years, though, so we thought it would do for you. No electric light, I'm afraid. We can't afford that in here right now. But it's warm and it's dry, and it's all yours, so you won't be disturbed if you don't want to be."
She showed him how to work the lamp, then wished him good night and left. Flip unpacked his clothes and put them away. Then he slid his two suitcases under the bed. He put the heavy case at the back so nobody could see it. As he straightened up, he looked out of the window. Standing on the far side of the road that led to the village was the girl with the white hair. She was clutching her teddy bear and gazing up at the barn. When she saw Flip looking back, she spun round and darted away across the fields. Within less than a minute, like a ghost, she'd vanished entirely from sight. Chapter 3. A Thief. Flip had known his dad was a thief, but it had taken him a long time to realise it, even though the boxes had been around for as long as he could remember. They'd appeared every few months or so, stacked up in the kitchen of their flat. Flip had looked in them once and found dozens of new shirts. Another time he'd found transistor radios and watches. A third time it had been bottles of whiskey and gin and rum. When he'd asked what they were doing there, his dad had always given him the same answer. "Oh, I'm just keeping them for a friend. He'll come and get them soon." And until he was 8, Flip had believed him. because when he came home from school or got up the next day, the boxes would be gone. Always. He went on believing his dad until he met Willem Vane. Willem Vane led the school's meanest gang. They loved strolling through the corridors, pushing kids to one side, knocking books out of their hands, and helping themselves to sweets or toys or anything else they liked the look of. Any time anybody ever resisted or complained or tried to fight back, Willem would always yell the same thing. "You can't hit me! My dad's a policeman! You hit me and he'll arrest you!" And because everyone had seen Willem's dad in his uniform and seen how tall and menacing he looked, they were only too ready to believe the threat. Flip certainly believed it and did his best to stay out of Willem's way. Unfortunately for him, Willem had other ideas. One day, he trapped Flip in a corner of the schoolyard and jabbed a finger in his face. "My dad knows about your dad," he sneered. "He says your dad's a thief." Flip hadn't got the slightest idea what Willem was talking about, and he said so. Willem repeated his accusation. Flip tried to ignore him and walk away, but Willem's gang had arrived by then and surrounded him, so Flip got angry. "Well, if he is a thief," he demanded, "why doesn't your dad arrest him?" "Because the police are gathering evidence," Willem said. "That's what the police do. If you weren't an idiot, you'd know that." "I'm not an idiot," Flip shouted, pushing him away, "but you're a liar." Willem knocked him to the ground. He knocked him to the ground when they had the same argument the following week, and in the weeks after that. Then one day, he knocked him to the ground and stood on Flip's hands. He was wearing heavy boots that cut deep into Flip's knuckles and made them bleed. They were still bleeding when he went home, and both his mum and his dad were there to see it. When they asked what had happened, Flip told them. His mum rounded instantly on her husband. "Those wretched boxes!" she shouted. "Now your son's getting hurt because of them!" Flip's dad didn't answer her, and he didn't look shocked. Instead, he looked angry. "What did you say about them?" he demanded. The expression on his face made Flip step back in surprise. "About what?" he asked. "About the boxes. What did you say about the boxes?"
"Nothing."
Flip didn't understand what was going on.
"Are you sure?"
"Positive," Flip said. "I didn't say a word."
"Good," his dad snapped. His voice was hard and cold. "And you never will, you hear? You will never, ever say one word about those boxes. Do you hear me?"
Then he grabbed his jacket and stormed out of the flat. He didn't come back until the next morning. Flip's mother cleaned the cuts on his hands, put plasters on them, and took him out for an ice cream. They sat on a bench beside a canal and watched the ducks paddle up to beg for crumbs from the wafers. Eventually, Flip asked if what Willem Vane had said about his dad was true. His mum sighed sadly.
"Yes," she said, "it is."
"But he could go to prison," Flip said, "if he's caught."
"I know," his mum said, "and I've tried to get him to stop, but he won't. He doesn't want to."
She stared down into the water.
"But now you've been hurt, perhaps he'll change his mind. Will you ask him again?"
Flip didn't want his dad to go to prison, but he didn't want to go on getting bullied at school either.
"Yes," his mum said, "I will."
"Do you promise?" Flip asked. His mum smiled and drew a cross in the air with her finger. Then she drew a circle around the cross. Flip smiled, because that was their private sign, and whenever either of them made it, they always did what they'd promised. Whether it was going to bed on time, cooking something special for dinner, doing homework or going out to the cinema, the cross in the circle always meant it would happen. Flip's mum did ask, but it didn't make any difference. The boxes kept appearing. One night, Flip lay in bed listening to his parents arguing and heard his mum threaten to leave. She said she'd run away from Amsterdam and take Flip with her. His dad laughed and said she wouldn't because she didn't have any money.
"Oh, yes, I do," she shot back, "and if you're not careful, I'll use it."
His dad was quiet after that, and for the next couple of weeks the boxes stopped appearing. Flip felt happier. His mum even started to cheer up. It looked as though her request had worked. Then one afternoon, Flip came home to find her sitting in the kitchen crying. He asked her what was wrong.
"He took my money," she sobbed. "All the money I'd ever saved in my life. He found it and took it, and now I've got nothing."
"Who?" Flip asked, even though he knew what the answer would be.
"Me," yelled his father, stomping into the kitchen. He pointed a finger at his wife. "I said you'd never leave me, and now I've made certain you won't, and don't think you can ever hide anything from me again. Got it?"
2 weeks later, Flip's mum left. She went without any warning. When Flip went to school, she was at home. When he came back, she wasn't. He found his dad sitting at the kitchen table looking at a letter.
"Your mother's gone," he said when Flip asked him what it said. "She's left us."
He was so angry he could hardly get the words out of his mouth. "Why?" Flip asked. The only answer his dad gave was to rip the piece of paper into scraps and flush them away down the toilet. He went out without another word, leaving Flip on his own. Which turned out to be a good thing, because it meant that when Flip found the letter under his pillow at bedtime, his dad wasn't there to tear that up too. "My dear darling Flip," it said, "I know this is a terrible thing I'm doing, and it makes me sadder than I'd ever thought I could feel. But I'm going away so I can make enough money to look after us both. I've found a job, and it's going to pay me a lot, but they won't hire me if I have my son with me, and I have to stay away so I can be sure I keep everything I earn. I have to be sure it won't get stolen again. But believe me, when I've saved up what we need, I'm going to come back and get you. I don't know when that will be, but it will be one day. I will come back for you. I will come back. Mum." At the bottom of the letter was a little cross in a little circle, and when Flip saw that, he didn't feel quite so bad anymore, because he knew his mum would keep her word and return. He put the letter in the envelope and hid the envelope under the mattress. And then he waited. Months became a year. 1 year became two. The second year became the third. She sent postcards in the first few months, although Flip never managed to read them, because his dad tore them up and threw them away the moment they arrived. Then they stopped for good, and all Flip had to remind him of her was the letter she'd written. When it grew dangerously worn and faded from being looked at so many times, he folded it in quarters and slid it between two thin sheets of cardboard to protect it. By then, of course, he knew every word in it by heart and could recite it to himself in silence. But he guarded it as though it were the most valuable treasure in the world, because it was the last thing his mum had ever given him, and he had vowed never, ever to let it disappear. As for his dad, he just went on stealing. Piles of new boxes would appear almost every week, to be collected by threatening-looking men who talked only in whispers. Sometimes the police came, but they never found anything, even though they searched the entire flat. That was something his dad was good at, making sure they never did. Then one day the police came, and they weren't looking for boxes. It was Wednesday, the 6th of July, 1966. It was Flip's 12th birthday. The knock on the door woke him up at 3 o'clock in the morning. Two policemen were standing in the hall. They wanted to know whether Turnbull lived there, and when Flip said yes, that was his father, they got a funny look on their faces and asked if they could come in. One of them then produced a waterlogged wallet from his pocket, cleared his throat, and asked Flip if he recognised it. Flip did. It was his dad's. Then the policeman said that just after midnight, someone had stolen a car and driven off the road into the Brewer's Canal. Because of the dark, no one had been able to get to it in time and stop the man inside from drowning.
But that's my dad's wallet, Flip said. The policeman cleared his throat a second time.
I know, he said. It was in the pocket of the man.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.